When I was a child, I had a dream of changing the world, but somewhere along the lines, that dream faded away. I guess I felt like there was nothing I could do or nothing any of us could do to really make a difference, and if we did, no one would listen. That all changed the day I met a man in the desert who dreams with his hands. A man who built a theme park that nobody ever went to. A man who has the answers to free energy, ecological disaster relief, heck, even world peace. A man who needs your help.
Sorry, do you guys know how to get to theme park in the making? What? Theme park in the making?
We don't live here.
Oh, okay.
Theme Thank park. You.
What kind of park is it? I mean, what they have.
Never even heard of it.
Never heard of it.
Theme park in the making.
Right.
Who?
Theme park in the making.
Theme park in the making.
Looks like something's going on.
Theme park in the making. I don't know what it is, really.
Theme park in the making.
I don't. We're not from here.
Hey, do you know how to get to theme park in the making?
No.
To get to what? Theme park in the making?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you do?
Mr. Pittman's?
Yeah.
You go, you know where Florida is?
Yeah.
Just get on Florida and head north, and it's before you get to Highway 84.
Okay.
82.
Right.
Okay, off Florida.
Yes. Yeah, you'll see it.
Okay. Do you know what it is at all?
I think we should let you decide.
Theme park.
In the making?
This man's name is Mike Pittman. Mike Pittman was born in Taunton, New Mexico, to the son of a goldsmith. He lives in Alamogordo, New Mexico, right between Alamogordo and La Luz, that is, next to the Snake Pit Pawn Shop. Now, people around town have mixed feelings about Mike, but don't just take my word for it. Let's meet some of Mike's neighbors.
Long story short, one time we got asked not so politely by Pittman with a shotgun to vacate his premises.
So we heard that Pittman likes milk, so we brought a peace offering of milk,
right?
See how that goes over.
You go knock, dude. I'm not down with this.
What, dude?
At all.
What's the worst you can have, dude?
Pittman's gonna be coming down to 86. Come on. Just get this quick shot. Look at this.
What the heck, dude?
Hey. What, you see something?
He's got this just random truck running out here, so he's got to be around here somewhere, but it's just sitting there running.
It must be like the before and after or something. Oh, fuck, dude. I'm out of here.
What?
Oh.
Alright, get ready to take off and forget it. I think it's important to notice that it's impossible to talk about Mike the man without talking about Mike the engineer. Because you see, in southern New Mexico during the late 1970s to the mid 1990s, Mike was the only certified engineer to live in southern New Mexico. So you either dealt with Mike, if you're building something, or you get a guy from Texas or from Santa Fe and it takes a couple extra days. Now, while almost everybody who's built anything in this part of the state knows Mike, almost nobody knows that he has a theme park. Ladies and gentlemen, a theme park in the making.
Yeah, Mike Pittman.
Hey!
We're just kind of checking out the property here. We're wondering if maybe we could take a look around.
Sure.
Okay.
through here, I can kind of tell you sort of where it's done.
I'm Jack Bates. I own a construction company in Alamogordo. Started building houses there in 1980. And the first time that I met Mike Pittman was probably early part of 1980.
Yeah, we built this whole contraption in the basement of the shop. Brought it over here with a big front end loader and a crane and set it in place. He said this is actually concrete over styrofoam cells.
There's a lot of people think he's a crazy son of a bitch, but he's smarter than hell.
So this is just a round pin here, just for exercise horses.
My name is Marianne Thorpe. The first time I met Mike was we used to ride horses over in the area where his horse corrals were. And one day we just stopped and talked to him for a while.
So what did you use? You keep horses back here? Or?
Yeah, there's 28 stalls.
We actually bought a horse from there. That when we were riding through there one day, we saw a for sale sign there. The horses at that time were knee deep in manure. And we actually bought one of those horses and got it out of there and took it home with us. And then at one time there was horses that that were real, real skinny, and the stalls were falling down. One stall had fallen down, hit one on the back, and he had a big cut on him. And so we went ahead and called the sheriff at that time.
Notice that there's not any horses back here. Did you just decide not to do it anymore?
No, we had it. I had it full at one time when I first built it. It was just about full of horses. And had a lot of activity for us. We had a loudspeakers thing here and music and lights. You really can't make money doing things, something like that.
My name is John Lavin. The first experience was with a customer of mine who bought garage doors from me. I was putting the garage doors on a building that was designed by Mike Pittman.
Everything that I've done here over the past has been a challenging task. The first thing I did was excavate out the lakes, the lower lakes, which circulates water around the well to airlift station, and built the house.
So, can we go take a look at the lakes, maybe?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. After you.
Okay.
The machinery that he uses is all really antiquated stuff that barely runs. As it just sits there about 364 days out of the year, and then he'll try to fire it up. And it's stuff that you see in the old World War II films where the Army Corps of Engineers is making runways in the jungle.
We managed to get it over here, you know, and it runs okay. And
he gave it to you?
Yeah, just to get it off the property. You know, these old cranes are obsolete. You know. I'm going to use it to set a big the transmission and gear train, drive train from the big dozer that I did most of this work for. And I will optimistically put all these bleachers in, you know, for the audience achieved.
What would you say the approximate number of visitors the theme park in the making receives per year would be?
I don't know. I don't even know if it's open yet. I don't know that I would get on anything that was more than 6 feet tall. Something I'd be willing to fall off of.
I know what you're thinking. Jeff, that doesn't look like any kind of theme park I've ever seen. And you're right. It's not like any kind of theme park you've ever seen. There's no cartoon motif or an Old West theme or even a fairy tale village. Let me show you three attractions that make this theme park unique. The first attraction I'm going to show you is called the Water Energy Device.
Is this where the lake is?
Yeah, I built this, dug it out with that big dozer that I'm turning down.
My name is Pat Vandergriff. The positions that I've held in the past
starting at about 1978. I graduated with degrees in engineering and business administration.
Everything I did, I just done myself. I batched the concrete with that big backhoe built thing that I started with.
I've had him come up with designs one time on a structure where it was a beam and column support, where I was quite perplexed with the idea of how that it was going to actually work for a residential structure. And he came up with a design that was really quite intriguing.
Well, Mike, I got to tell you, I'm a pretty big fan of the diving boards, but these ones here, I got about 2 foot on it earlier.
Yeah, they're what kind of makes people nervous, see those booms that are kind of levered, and see the steel that goes down.
Yeah.
That's what I'm going to put the middle on. It's going to generate, I can use the mitosis to generate electricity with. And I have, even have a generator. Maybe if someone buys this thing park, they can afford it. But
right.
Anyway, that's
have you had any offers or anything yet?
No, not yet. I've had some people call, but they just, more. One guy called and said, what about all that junk?
At one time that he had stuff for sale, and then he had signs go up that none of it was for sale.
In fact, it made me so mad that after a while I called him back. I had his phone and kind of chewed on him a little bit, because that's kind of arrogant. But anyway,
So when the water runs through this area here, and generate a little past that we're under the diving boards, and then it flows out that way?
Yeah, it goes through this lower lane, around, and it's lifting up a lift station. This is a concrete slab here. The water kind of picks the water up a little bit, lets it go in a more even flow. But the mill wheel goes right there, suspended up by those big bars, and drops 14 feet. That Ooh. Creates energy for, yeah, then there's quite a flow. There's like
how much water?
Maybe 20,000 gallons a minute, that come through the canal. This water, as it goes around and it lifts up a big lift station, goes into another lake up there. I'll show it to you when we go over that way. And then from that upper lake, it's brought back into here.
That's slide operational?
Behind the bridge, it picks it up, a small one, it picks it up from the big one. But it don't have as much lift, so it still can keep the volume up, and it goes under the water gun, comes under the bridge, and then through the canal.
It was brand new, and it was all concrete, pre-stressed, with a pre-stressed concrete roof, and it was scary. It was scary to even go inside. I was afraid to go in and hang the garage doors in it and have that over my head.
My game bird permit, I could raise anything, but I'm pretty much now down to just raising gamble quail.
Is that other thing up there? Is that part of the quail?
No, that was, I had a contract with both.
There again, here, available, capable of looking at the job. You send him his direction and they can get, fast resolution, get a certification of what's needed, or if nothing's needed, certification that it's okay. And they can move on with their project and get their approvals. Those are the types of things I've sent him.
From about 82, I'd say, everything that I did, I had to use Mike on one part of it or the other.
But I had the whole 28 acres, But then I'm going to sell the 16 across the street and keep this 12 to start making these RVs, hopefully, trailer RVs, amphibious RVs.
Basically looks like a junkyard on both sides of the road. It's a junkyard. In any other state besides New Mexico, he would probably be in trouble with the zoning laws.
He was working on an old building and it gutted out, and some outdoor bathrooms. And I asked him what he was doing. He said he's making an indoor movie theater. And I says, wow, well, how good that is or
not. This right here is the bathrooms, the public bathrooms that I kind of got ahead of myself, but that's what I built that.
Right. Well, if you build it, they will pee.
Right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I had a little, up on top of that, I have a hot tub up in the top. And I was going to put a sign on the wall facing the street.
Yeah.
Caution, new bathers. And if they got after me, I was going to say, well, I'm just trying to warn people.
Right.
Might be up there naked.
What do you think's holding back from really bringing this theme park to the public? Because you live pretty close to him and you haven't even heard of it.
Well, if you look at across the street at the mess that he's got across the street there, and I think that he just... I have no idea what he's doing.
The stuff that we saw kind of when we were headed over across the street from the west side of Theme Park in the Making over into, do you have a name for the east side?
I'm starting to call that Theme Park in the Making.
Gotcha.
The east side. And the west side now is the RV trailer manufactured.
So when we were coming in here, these green boxes in the building, what's all that kind of stuff?
Okay, those are missile tubes that I built a storage shed with, but it also supports a beam, backside of it, a long I-beam that holds the traveling jaws that makes the long metal plate connected wood trusses that makes up these amphibious RVs.
Amphibious RV?
Well, they're pulled to wherever you want them, to the lakeshore or ocean shore, and then the tongue and axles come out of them because of the way they're constructed. Then you put pontoons in underneath where the tongue and axles was and connect onto a propeller that allows you then to use the same pickup.
I wish you had some kind of prototype or something.
Yeah, well, I have something built up.
The next attraction I'd like to show you is the oil skimmer. Now, this is a boat, but again, it's probably not like any boat you've ever seen. That's a truck as the engine of this boat.
Well, here she is, huh?
Yeah.
Right by a skimmer. Now, what exactly does that mean?
It will just skim oil off the water.
Right.
And it'll be a shallow raft. And from here, pontoons attach and will drop down. Lavatory here, commode there, two bunk beds here.
How many people a year would you estimate visit Theme Park in the Making?
I, honest to goodness, would have to say I have no foggy idea.
These propellers are real, real economical and small, high velocity, because you need a shield over that. You know, you have to have a shield on the airboat. Now you can see that you're liable to get the thing going if you're not careful. it's actually a pretty good engine, pretty good motor right now.
Wow.
So good.
Can't wait to see what you got in the works.
I'll get me some water there if y'all got something to drink out of it.
How about we cut the tops off them cans?
There's another one of them downstairs that I made a cup out of. It won't cut your face.
It's gonna work it when it's got the... Here's kind of what I think will work. Let me just, this is the profile of it, and I'll just blow this up. You know, we were talking over there about, you know, I don't know if he got a shot of this bottom part of this tower, the turns.
Right, yeah,
so,
he did.
Yeah. Okay, so this, what happened, and this is a balloon, a full-size top of a hot air balloon. Yeah, so this is a section view. This is the top view of it, of the grandstands, you know, on top around it. So what this is a platform
in this case, you can auction stuff off, even automobiles.
It's like when he had the duck races out there in the ponds. And the auction site that nobody ever bought anything from.
I never saw any duck races there.
You could get a lot out of a theater that you can move in front of an audience.
We started finding that there's a lot of things missing in the specs and in the plans.
But by far my favorite attraction is one that hasn't been built yet. This attraction is still in the drafting stages. It is also a boat, but it has a completely different set of principles. It was built on this concept. Since the beginning of time, man has been at war with himself. If we can't stop it, we can at least minimize the damage, and it all starts right here. First of all, this boat is filled with hundreds of horses. As you can see, the horses actually power the boat. The boat then travels to every continent on this planet and picks up individuals from every nation on the planet. They head back to New Mexico, where they enter the fenced-in area that Mike has prepared for. Inside of this fenced-in area, they will battle to the death on horseback with single-action weaponry. But there's video cameras surrounding the perimeter, so everyone can tune in at home, fulfill that bloodlust without having to go to war to kill millions of people.
Before you get too far into it, could you take us from, like, conception of the idea to what the ultimate goal is from step to step, so I don't have to paraphrase your idea?
I'll tell you exactly what happened. You know, when they hit the Twin Towers, my TV was out, but I drove up to my little trailer, and there was a contractor there. And my first, he said, "Did you hear about what happened?" I said, "No," but then he told me.
Right.
And my first reaction was, we ought to do some serious apologizing.
His eccentricity diminishes his credibility.
Now, I'll ask you, I mean, you know, who takes a very, very expensive method and builds horse stables out of it? That would be Mike Pittman.
As we went through today with Mike, really, I mean, we were just happy to get an interview at all. We were kind of scared to even come up on the property when we first came here. We're like, you know, maybe this guy's just going to run us off. But as we went through the day, we went through some, I mean, amazing ideas. Free energy through moving water, also ecological cleanup for ecological disasters, also entertainment value and how entertainment can be used to help the general public while creating free energy. Now, the question that we're posing to Mike, what would be your idea for world peace?
Okay, it would be to make it more acceptable. Make the world realize that a good way to have wars is off horseback, or with, if not, at least with single action weaponry.
I think some of them like him, some of them don't care for him, but they still use him.
And it becomes so interesting to the world that they would just tune in, you know, and they would begin to root for success, especially so many of these other countries, you know, that have been so aggravated at the way the U.S. has approached the terrorism and so forth. But I believe that it would be something that would catch on and would really, really could make the whole world think, well, you know, this. Obviously, we're going to have wars. We've been at war all our since we evolved.
Right.
Why do we think we're not going to want to continue? You know. Mm-hmm. So but let's make it fun. Let's at least make it like a football. Like we watch football. We do that for the very same reason.
I think he did have good intentions at one time, but I don't know what happened. I have no idea what happened to him.
To me, it's interesting. If you want to have some wars, have it between two class, different types of horses, you know, like quarter horses and Arabian horses, you know, and both of them good in their own field, but you only use single action weaponry. Like you can have a 30-30, you can have a pistol. All of them requires a single action, like a pull the trigger,
right,
or shoot the gun, like that.
Right.
No automatic, you just pull the trigger and just
lived
hopefully
last
best.
Year. Yeah. So that was my, and I mean, since 9/11, I've worked for the longest to try to get people interested in that concept with this website, but just never succeeded. So lately, I've got this new website, which is more logical because it'll lead in to the manufacturer of the kind of craft that could take horses over there, and you could propel them with pickup trucks, you know, but the horses would be there. In other words, in this one I've got expands out, the horses could stand out and be propelled with the craft, the smaller crafts. But if you have 10,000 of them, you can move a lot of horses over there, you know, and it'd be much more fun for everybody, you know,
right.
and make it just a really world spectacle for entertainment, you know. Then the tariffs would just disappear. We wouldn't be spending trillions of dollars because they would start to respect this country.
Well, thanks a lot.
You bet.
I'll stop by again sometime.
Okay.
And you want to give your address just so people can stop by the theme park in the making?
Yeah, it's 4788 North Florida Avenue.
North Florida Avenue.
Alamogordo, New Mexico.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Mike.
All right.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mike is giving us a special honor today, the golden ticket to each and every one of you who choose to autograph the documents I put in front of you. This golden ticket is redeemable for the premier voyage of the oil skimmer.
I just literally, you know, get nothing from the community. It's just what I do, period. I can't even get my own damn kids to interested. I think that there'll be a point in time when it'll just suddenly happen. And I'm thinking, you get these boats launched on the ocean with horses on them, you know, enough just for at least for the publicity, and enough of them where I can like have. It would be like an armada that would kind of begin working its way across the Atlantic for the purpose of becoming a substitute for the kind of wars that's going on now, you know. And I just, it's just something to do, I guess, in my old age. But I believe it'll. I'm enthusiastic about it. In other words, when I want to make money, but not, I have a better reason for making money now. In fact, when I build it, I'm going to try to get it down on a lake, probably down to Elephant Butte, you know. And what y'all could do, if you could be there when we launch it, that would be, you know, that then the publicity from that would be great. They'd say, there goes Mike Pittman. He invented the leaf boat. But the leaf boat would have to be a completely accepted type of boat that would be way better than other boats for traveling across oceans, you know, or lakes or any place, you know. And I believe this boat that I'm doing will. Good luck. I hope y'all can get something out of this that will... that people will find interesting, and I hope you can talk about a little bit about what I'm trying to do. At some point, an opportunity will kind of develop to get, as an alternative for religions, you know, and war, you know, the type of wars that we have, and just a way of life for everyone, and the planet, you know, could use some help. If something happened and changed it, then it might extend Earth's life a few billions years, you know. I mean, just a single thing of changing humans' attitudes, you know, could extend the life of Earth.